Hello, I'm Keith Jolly and I'm a senior researcher in Martin Maiden's group in the Department of Zoology, University of Oxford. I've been developing databases and software for genetic and genomic epidemiology and analysis for nearly 20 years now, and today I will be introducing the PubMLST website and associated databases and hopefully providing a taste of what data we have available and how it can be used. PubMLST is a website that hosts large curated datasets of genomic, provenance, and phenotypic information. It was originally developed to host multilocus sequence typing schemes and associated isolate records. And as you can see from the slide, we have a lot of data now, over 850,000 isolate records, and of those, over 600,000 have genome assemblies associated with them. Now, it's important to note that this is not just a genome database, but it can contain records with any amount of sequence information available, and that can range from single gene typing up to whole genome assemblies. The website hosts separate databases for over 120 different organisms. Many of these are single species, but some are for a whole genus, such as Neisseria. A few of these databases are curated by our group in Oxford, but we also host many that have been set up at the request of the community and are curated by third-party users. These are usually because somebody has developed a sequence typing scheme which they want to make available, and we do so on the condition that they oversee ongoing curation of those datasets. The website is called PubMLST, but the underlying software that I developed to host these databases is called BiXDB, and this stands for Bacterial Isolate Genome Sequence Database. Now, this software has been designed to bring together isolate provenance and other metadata, along with any amount of sequence data, which can range from single gene sequences up to complete genome assemblies. And we can apply annotation to these based on typing schemes or sequence information for any loci of interest, which may in some cases be linked to phenotype. The basic design philosophy of BiXDB is quite simple. We have two sides to the system. On the left-hand side, we have a series of sequence definition databases which contain all known sequence variants for each locus that we're interested in. And each of these sequences has an identifier or an allele number. Then on the right-hand side, we have an isolate database that contains everything that we know about an isolate, such as where it was isolated from, by whom and when, what disease it caused, and so on. And these isolate records have a sequence bin into which we can place any sequence data for that record. And this can be a genome assembly. In order to analyze, we then perform a BLAST query of the sequence bin, which against the sequence definition databases, in order to identify any known allelic variants for each of the loci in turn. And if we find a known variant for a locus, then we record this in the database along with its position. And we can then use these stored results going forward. And we can also identify any sort of new alleles for a particular locus. And if we do that, then those get assigned into the database so that they can be discovered, they can be found again in the future. So just to reiterate the two sides of the system, we have two database structures, the first of which is for nomenclature, containing every known allelic variant of a locus. It can also contain allelic profiles for schemes such as MLST, where we assign sequence type numbers to each unique combination of particular alleles that we find. Then we have the isolate database that contains provenance information, such as location and date of isolation, possibly phenotype, and sequence data, such as a genome assembly. I realise this is Chicken Journal Club, so we do have data that is related to chickens. In particular, the Campylobacter databases, which are curated by Fran Collis, who you've heard from in an earlier talk. These databases have over 100,000 isolates, many of which are either from chickens or from humans suffering from food poisoning associated with chickens. Now, over 50,000 of these isolate records have genome assemblies, and we can analyse these using a number of typing schemes, which vary in the number of loci they have, and hence the resolution. So we have standard traditional MLST, which has 7 loci, And this is a scheme that has been used to define the clonal complexes. We then have ribosomal MLST, which uses 53 ribosomal protein genes. And this scheme actually works for all bacteria, not just Campylobacter. And then finally, we have a core genome MLST scheme that has over 1,300 loci. And this gives you sort of genome level resolution, which can be used when resolving outbreaks. Now, which scheme you use very much depends on what question you are trying to address, and of course, what data you have available. You can only really do ribosomal MLST and core genome MLST if you have a genome sequence, but you can compare everything using 7-locus MLST. If we look at an example isolate record, in this case from the Neisseria database, which I'm a curator on, we can see what kind of information we can store. So first of all, in the top section, we can group records into projects, which makes it easy to organize coherent data sets. Then we have provenance metadata. So this is country, year, disease, biological source, along with information about who submitted it and when, and when it was last updated. And we can add any field we want to the database. So these tend to vary depending on the organism. We can sometimes extract useful phenotypic predictions from genomes. So here we have indications of vaccine effectiveness based on which variants are encoded in the genome compared to known cross-reactivity with variants that are included in particular vaccines. In this example, it shows that there is an exact match to a vaccine variant. So this isolate would be expected to be covered by the vaccine. Then we can link isolates to publication records and then readily get to other isolates included in a publication. So along with projects, this can give us coherent data sets. And then at the bottom, we have some information about the sequence bin. So this is a number of contigs, the total length, N50 value, etc. And we can click the link to get a more detailed analysis of this. We can cluster isolates based on core genome schemes using different allelic match thresholds. So this enables us to find similar isolates in the database directly from a genome sequence. Then we have different schemes that are set up. We've so far only mentioned typing schemes, but we can include schemes that group loci based on any criteria. And for Neisseria, we have done this for biochemical characteristics and enzyme pathways, with the ultimate aim here to be able to link genotype and phenotype. And then finally, at the bottom, there are tools that we can run using the genome sequence in this record. For example, an in silico PCR tool, which is useful for testing primers. You can query the isolate database by any of the stored fields and derive characteristics, such as genome quality metrics. The query form is completely customizable, and it is possible to enable different form elements depending on what you want to search by. Once you have performed a query, there is a wide range of things you can do with the return data set. This ranges from breakdowns of the data by fields. You can do pivot tables where you're examining the values of one field based on the values found in other fields. You can examine the sequence bin in detail, export in various formats, or perform some fairly complex comparative genomics. The genome comparator tool allows you to compare up to about 1,500 genomes at a time at every locus in either a defined typing scheme, such as core genome MLST, or by using the loci that are annotated in a reference genome. In the image, each coloured column represents a single genome, and we're using the loci, or gene sequences, found in a reference sequence, which are represented by the rows. So we call the reference sequence allele number, we call it allele 1 for each locus. Then if we find the exact same sequence in our genomes, then it is also called allele 1. But if we find the sequence varies, then we call allele 2, then allele 3, and so on for each new allele. This creates effectively an ad hoc whole genome MLST analysis, and we can then determine the relatedness of each pair of genomes by simply counting the number of loci that differ between the records. When we count the pairwise allelic differences, we can then create a distance matrix where we are treating the number of allelic differences as a genetic distance. Just by reading the numbers from this matrix, it's possible to find which isolates are most similar to each other. You can think of a distance matrix in the same way you may consider the distances between cities listed on the back of road atlases in the days before we all had GPS. Here I have entered the distances in miles between cities in the United States, and we can feed this matrix into an algorithm that gives us a visual representation of these distances. We commonly use the NeighborNet algorithm to draw networks linking points based on these distances, and when I use a city distance matrix, this perfectly reconstructs the map of the USA. So you'll see each of the points on the network are positioned as shown on the geographic map on the right. We can treat genetic distances in exactly the same way. In this case, I've reconstructed a meningococcal university disease outbreak where there were multiple related strains circulating in the student population, but we were very easily able to see which strains were related using their genome sequences. Another tool which is very useful for comparative genomics is Grape Tree. This has been written by another group, but is open source software, and we've been able to incorporate it into PubMLST. Now, this tool has been designed to handle tens of thousands of genomes using core genome MLST schemes, and it produces minimum spanning trees on which you can overlay metadata by colouring the nodes. Now this is very useful for exploring datasets to identify trends in fields where characteristics are linked to their genetic relatedness. That was a very quick overview of PubMLST. You can read a lot more about the design and rationale behind the software in our Welcome Open Research paper that was published in 2018. I would like to acknowledge that PubMLST is funded by a Wellcome Trust Biomedical Resource Grant, and we also thank all the efforts of a large team of curators from all over the world. Finally, I'd like to plug PubMLST online forum events. We run these every couple of months, and these cover different topics. We have done a session on Campylobacter surveillance and research and how PubMLST has had an impact on that. These are all recorded and are available on the PubMLST YouTube channel. We have another event coming up on June the 11th, which is geared towards sexually transmitted infections. And I would encourage anyone who may be interested to sign up and attend these. So that's all I have to say, but thank you very much.